Welcome to lecture 24 of Foundations of Artificial Intelligence. Today we're going to be learning about rule-based machine learning. In our last lecture, we covered the basics of what machine learning is and walked through an example of a machine learning analysis pipeline, including the phases of pre-processing, feature processing, modeling, and finally post-analysis. In today's lecture, we're going to start with an introduction to rule-based machine learning and cover what it is. Then we'll take a look at three different families of rule-based machine learning, including association rule mining, with focus on the a priori algorithm, artificial immune systems, and learning classifier systems. To start, rule-based machine learning, or RBML, is a general paradigm of piecewise machine learning. By rule-based, we mean that the solution or model that we're generating is collectively comprised of a bunch of individual rules, typically of the form of if-then. So for example, if red and octagon, then stop sign. What are some other algorithms that fall under the label of rule-based machine learning? As mentioned just a moment ago, these include association rule mining, artificial immune systems, and two genres of learning classifier systems called Pittsburgh-style and Michigan-style learning classifier systems. Today's lecture is going to focus mostly on Michigan-style, but we'll mention briefly what Pittsburgh-style systems are as well. First up, let's talk about association rule mining. Association rule mining, or ARM, was developed primarily for discovering interesting relationships between variables in large datasets. So in other words, looking for frequent patterns, associations, correlations, or causal structures between features, and not necessarily trying to predict any outcome. This algorithm was originally designed for situations where we were trying to predict what products might be bought together in a store, for example. So given a set of transactions, find rules that will predict purchase associations among items. So this kind of method can be used to understand customer buying habits, for example. The if-then rules that are generated link independent variables to some other independent variable as such. So maybe if you purchase these three items, you're more likely to purchase this item as well. It's easiest to think about this kind of algorithm in the context of figuring out what people will buy at the same time in a grocery store. So for example, if 98% of people who purchased items A and B also happened to purchase item C, it might be a good idea for the grocery store to put all three of those items in the same location, either to make it more convenient for the consumer, or to increase the likelihood that they'll buy all three items. Here's a simple example of association rule mining in action. Let's say this is our list of transactions. Each one of these rows indicates the items that a customer might have bought on one trip to the store. So on trip one, somebody purchased bread and milk together. In another, somebody purchased bread, diapers, beer, and eggs. On another, milk, diapers, beer, and cola. Then another, bread, milk, diapers, beer. And yet another, bread, milk, diapers, and cola. One of the few patterns that you might see pop up here is the co-occurrence of diapers and beer together in purchases. Because of this frequent co-occurrence, association rule mining can use this information to create rules. In other words, if diapers are purchased, then it's likely that beer will be purchased. To understand association rule mining, let's first look at two ways to evaluate rules, specifically support and confidence. Before diving into these definitions, here's an example rule. If A is purchased, then it's likely B will be purchased with a given support and confidence. Support denotes the frequency of the rule within transactions. A high value means that the rule covers a larger part of the database, or a larger percentage of the transactions made in the database. Support is calculated as the union of co-occurrence of both A and B in this example, or the count of the number of transactions in which both A and B were included together. Confidence, on the other hand, denotes the percentage of transactions containing A which also contain B. It's basically an estimation of the conditioned probability. So here, confidence is the probability of B given A, or the support for A and B together divided by the support for just A. Let's take a simple look at association rule mining in action. Here we have a short list of transactions and the items that were bought together in each of these transactions. In trying to discover rules, we might set minimum support and confidence for their discovery. So here we look for any frequent item set with at least 50% support. And these are the ones that are found in the database. So for example, A on its own exists in 75% of the transactions, B exists in 50% of the transactions, C also in 50%, and A and C together occurs in 50% of the transactions. So honing in on rule if A then C, we have a support of 50%, and in this case, we have a confidence of 66.6%, which is 50 over 75. Association rules can predict any attribute and combination of attributes. But the problem here is that there could be an immense number of possible associations, especially in a dataset with a larger number of features or transactions. This can lead to far too many rules to sift through in any useful way. So here the output needs to be restricted to show only the most predictive associations, or in other words, only those with the highest support and confidence. One way to tackle one of these problems is to use Boolean association rules. So let's say that we have a number of transactions where different items were bought in each situation. Each ticket represents a specific transaction with items labeled as A 1 through 13. We then can create a binary data set where all rows indicate transactions and all columns indicate possible items that we might be purchasing. If the item was purchased in a transaction, it gets a 1, and if it wasn't, it gets a 0. Now that we know the basics of an association rule mining algorithm, let's take a look at a specific example of this class of algorithm, the a priori algorithm. In essence, the a priori algorithm seeks to make association rule mining more efficient. This is a multi-pass algorithm that focuses on monotonicity. The idea behind it is that if a set of items appears at least S times, so does every subset found within that set. Another way of looking at this inversely is the contrapositive. In other words, if item I does not appear in any of S baskets, then no pair, including I, can appear in those S baskets. We use this basic intuition to hone in the search for association rules. So again, here's that main law of the a priori algorithm. Any subset of a frequent item set must also be frequent. A specific example of this would be a transaction containing beer, diapers, and nuts also just contains the subset beer and diapers. So if beer, diaper, and nuts is a frequent co-purchase, then so should be beer and diaper together. Also, this means that no superset, or in other words, a set like this containing one other item, of any infrequent item set should be generated or even tested because it's unlikely to produce anything fruitful. So many of these item combinations can be pruned and left out of further search. Here's a way to illustrate the association rule mining search, starting with individual items and then unique pairings of these items, followed by unique triples and unique quadruples, and finally all five together. The goal with a priori is to identify which of these combinations is informative or has a high support or confidence. Obviously, this is a simple example, and we could have a much larger item lattice if there are a larger number of variables to consider. Imagine, for example, every item in a grocery store. Using the knowledge that if any item set is infrequent, then all of its supersets must also be infrequent, we can target any set that is infrequent, let's say AB, and decide that we're going to prune from consideration all supersets including AB afterwards. This means that we don't have to search this entire part of this web. Now we know how to prune, but let's look a little more formally at how we'll actually expand upon frequent item sets. Armed with the knowledge that a subset of a frequent item set must also be a frequent item set, a priori will generate length k plus 1 candidate item sets from any length k frequent item sets, and we'll test these candidates against the database to determine which in fact are frequent. This process is pretty simple and straightforward. Here's a more specific example of the a priori algorithm in action. Starting with a database D, where we have different transactions and items being purchased numbered 1 through 5, we first scan the database and look for individual items with a high level of support. So for example here, items 2, 3, and 5 have the highest support of 3. We might tell the algorithm ahead of time what minimum support we're willing to look for. So in this case, we're going to look for a minimum of 2 transactions. That means that we're going to prune this item set down, dropping this number 4 set. At this point, we're now going to expand upon these candidate item sets to a set of k plus 1 item sets. Recall at this point that we've dropped set 4 from consideration due to its low support. So now we look at all combinations of 1, 2, 3, and 5. Again, we scan the database and determine the support for each one of these unique combinations. And again, we'll drop any sets that are under the minimum support that we're requesting. This gives us some new pairwise candidate sets. Again, we're going to create k plus 1 sets, so now sets with 3 items, scan our database, again looking for support. This process continues until we don't find any more sets with at least some minimum support. Once we've discovered these frequent item sets, it's pretty simple to translate these into different possible rules. For example, given the frequent item set A, B, and E, we could generate any of the following association rules. So in other words, if item A is purchased, then B and E are likely to be purchased. Or if A and B are bought together, item E is likely to be bought together, and so forth. Recall that when we go about generating rules, We're identifying sets using support, but once we've generated the rules themselves from these sets, we might want to assign confidence to them, or only keep rules that have a high confidence or confidence above some threshold. This helps us to find frequent and confident rules that we can actually put into use. Furthermore, in evaluating our candidate rules, it can also be possible to evaluate these rules using some measure of interestingness. Basically, this is asking, are all of the strong association rules discovered interesting enough to present to the user? So in other words, if I'm applying association rule mining to a set of transactions from a grocery store that I'm collaborating with, what rules should I hand back to that user? So now we're left with the question of how do we actually measure the interestingness of a rule? Well, of course, these are generally subjective measures. And we could think of a rule pattern as being interesting if it's unexpected, in other words, it might be surprising to the user, and or it's actionable. There's something the user can actually do with it. So for example, if there's an item that usually needs to be refrigerated, closely paired with an item that needs to be frozen, it's not going to be terribly actionable to put those two items together in either the same freezer or the same fridge. At the end of the day, only the user can judge the interestingness of a rule. Now we're going to move on and talk about artificial immune systems. Before diving into the algorithm, let's first refresh some of the fundamentals of a biological immune system. Immunology, of course, is the study of defense mechanisms that confer defense against disease. The immune system is responsible to protect us from the attack of external microorganisms. There are several defense mechanisms, and these exist at several levels, and some of which are redundant. The immune system includes aspects of learning and memory. And when it comes to microorganisms or pathogens that might cause disease, these can include things like viruses, fungi, bacteria, and parasites. An antigen is any molecule that can stimulate the immune system. Now let's talk briefly about the adaptive immune system, which is the inspiration for artificial immune systems. These are anticipatory immune systems, and they include lymphocytes that carry antigen receptors on their surfaces. These antigen receptors are specific to a given antigen. Again, these antigens are the things we want to target as not self in the body. Clonal selection. When it comes to something called clonal selection, we're talking about B cells that recognize antigens that are stimulated and then proliferate or clone themselves and differentiate into both memory and plasma cells. These confer resistance against future infections. And they're capable of fine-tuning the cell receptors of the selected cells to the selected antigens. Now let's talk a little bit about artificial immune systems themselves. They were developed primarily for something called anomaly detection, which are basically algorithms designed to differentiate self and not self. You can think of this as an extreme form of classification where you have mostly self or mostly not self, and you're still trying to classify between them. Here, multiple antibodies, in other words, detectors, are learned, which collectively characterize self or non-self based on some affinity threshold. So in essence, we're going to be making rules that can potentially match closely or exactly instances from the data, and then we use these rules to determine if something is self or not self. Unlike most of the examples of rules we've looked at, where a rule has to match an instance exactly in order to be activated, in artificial immune systems, instead we rely on some affinity measure. This allows non-exact matching, where a rule can match an instance if it just closely matches that instance with some degree of affinity. We can use a variety of distance measures, such as Euclidean, Manhattan, and Hamming distance, to calculate the distance between a rule and an instance. Here, when we apply Hamming distance, we count the number of points where we see a different value, and then sum them up. From here on out, I'm going to talk about two particular families of artificial immune system algorithms. The first are negative selection algorithms. These were inspired by the positive and negative selection process that occur during the maturation of T cells in the thymus, called T cell tolerance. Negative selection refers to the identification and deletion, or apoptosis, of self-reacting cells, that is, T cells that may select for and attack self tissues. This class of algorithms are typically used for classification and pattern recognition problem domains, where the problem space is modeled in the complement of available knowledge. Here we're going to talk about negative selection algorithms in terms of a binary representation. The training of a negative selection algorithm is called the censoring phase. We start this algorithm by randomly generating attribute strings and then place them into some population. We then conduct affinity evaluation to test if strings in the population match any of the strings in the self or the set of self instances that we want to examine, or the instances of self that we're using as training examples. We then go ahead and generate our detector set. To do this, we ask if the affinity of a string R from our population, with at least one string of that set being larger than our chosen threshold, then we say that string R recognizes the self pattern. Because it recognizes self, we then need to eliminate string R. This is the negative selection part. Otherwise, R is added to our detector set. So effectively what we're doing here is trying to generate rules that identify things that are not self, and only not self. And anything that recognizes self is thrown out. Here's a simple schematic of the sensor phase right here, where again the goal is to generate potential non-self detectors. We start by generating random strings, which are basically candidate detectors. Here's our training set of self strings, and we ask if any of our random strings match with some affinity any of these self strings. If they do, we reject the candidate, and if they don't, we include them in our detector set. Once we've trained a detector set, and we want to actually apply it, we now turn this negative selection algorithm to its monitoring phase. Now we're using our detector set to try and determine if some other new strings either match or don't match. If they match, we can conclude that the string belongs to the non-self, and we can say that we've detected an instance of non-self. Now let's talk briefly about another variation of an artificial immune system. These are called clonal selection algorithms. This algorithm is modeled after the basic features of an adaptive immune response. Here we're dealing with antigens, which are typically encountered sequentially, and the immune system would respond with a subset of its immune cells, or those which come into contact with the antigens. The antigen selects several immune cells to proliferate, or clone. This proliferation rate is proportional to its affinity with the selective antigen. A higher affinity, the larger the number of the offspring. Mutation is the operator that's used here exclusively to generate variation in rules created by the clonal selection algorithm. And the frequency of mutation is going to be inversely proportional to the affinity of that rule. In other words, if we find a rule with a high affinity for the antigen, we don't want to change it all that much because it's already good for detecting non-self. If it has a low affinity, we're going to apply mutation to that rule to change it to hopefully make that rule more useful in the future. A clonal selection algorithm maintains two populations. One is that of the antigens. This is our environment, or the example training data. Here, instead of training on self examples, we're training on non-self examples. And then we also maintain a population of antibodies. These are our rules or current solutions. We start here again by randomly initializing the antibodies, and then for each we compute the affinity value for given antigens. This allows us to measure how well our antibody fits the antibody population. Next, some set of antibodies are selected, and here there's a preference for higher affinity. In other words, we want those rules that better identify non-self. This affinity is basically the fitness value that will be used later by an evolutionary component in this algorithm. Clones of these selected antibodies are generated proportional to their fitness. So now you're basically generating some clonal population of that target rule that had a higher affinity. Next, we apply hypermutation to each of these clones, where again our mutation rate is inversely proportional to the clone's fitness. Lastly, we update our new population and also generally include some new randomly generated individuals to maintain a higher diversity. This process cycles multiple times. Let's take a closer look at the fitness measure used in a clonal selection algorithm. We'll choose an antigen randomly, then choose without replacement a random sample of N antibodies, then match each antibody against the selected antigen. Now we add the match score of the highest affinity antibody, or the fitness of all other antibodies that have been fixed. We repeat this for many antigens, typically 3 times the number of antibodies. So lastly, from a bird's eye view, the clonal selection algorithm starts by building a random population of antigens and antibodies. We then match antibodies against antigens to determine their affinity. Next, we score the antibodies according to their affinity. And lastly, evolve the antibody repertoire using an evolutionary algorithm. And again, we use just mutation here, not crossover, like we've seen in genetic algorithms and genetic programming. The last type of rule-based machine learning algorithm we'll discuss today is that of learning classifier systems. This family of algorithms happens to be a target for my own research. And I'll start by saying that I think it's an extremely promising family of machine learning algorithms that is still largely untapped. Before diving into learning classifier systems themselves, I want to give a little bit of background motivation for why I got interested in the first place. My own research focuses quite a bit on a very basic problem, that of connecting potentially predictive variables to some phenotypic outcome. The pool of potentially predictive variables can come from genetic, environmental, or epigenetic sources, as well as many others. So we have this potentially very large pool of predictive variables, and we're trying to understand their relationship with some phenotypic outcome. These relationships can be simple, such as a univariate or Mendelian association. We can have pleiotropic effects, where a single variant can influence multiple phenotypic outcomes. We can have epistatic effects, where two or more features interact with one another in order to lead to a phenotypic effect. And sometimes these epistatic interactions can only be seen using algorithms that consider variables in combination, where methods that only explore univariate analysis would miss them. Another complicating phenomena is that of heterogeneous patterns of association, otherwise known as genetic heterogeneity or phenocopy. Here, independent variables or sets of variables can contribute to the same or similar phenotypic outcome. This is a particularly challenging problem for a lot of machine learning methods to tackle. And of course, there could be some messy combination of all of these different patterns of association. As I alluded to before, when it comes to disease complexity, there are lots of possible relationships between the variables and outcome. As we go from some basic univariate analysis, looking at each individual variable and its relationship with the outcome one at a time, to some more complex multivariate analysis, we quickly run into the curse of dimensionality, as we have to not only consider each variable alone in our search, but all unique combinations of those variables to look for higher order interactions or relationships. In characterizing different relationships between pairs of variables, we can first think of additive relationships, where we have two variables, one based on the color black and red, and the other down here on the x-axis. If we look at the impact of these two variables on phenotype, in an additive relationship, we can see that both variables contribute to the phenotype by themselves, and together, they form some basic additive combination. So if we just knew variable one, color, we could see here that it has a phenotypic effect. And if we also know variable two, and we go from A to B, we can see that it also has some individual effect. And the combined effect is just the addition of those two. A multiplicative interaction occurs when the directionality of the effect stays the same. In other words, it's some monotonic relationship. But now when considering both variables together, we have some exaggerated effect on phenotype beyond what we would get just by adding the two together. The most complicated form of interaction can be viewed as a crossover, where now if we only know variable one, the color, or variable two, we wouldn't be able to observe the phenotypic effect. And it's only when we look at those variables in combination with one another that we can understand the relationship with phenotype. These kinds of interactions are particularly difficult for a lot of simpler machine learners to detect. Next, let's discuss heterogeneous associations a little more. In genetics, you can think of heterogeneous associations as examples of genetic heterogeneity or phenocopy, where an environmental factor has the same effect on a phenotype as some genetic variable. So in thinking about a group of subjects with a disease of interest, we can imagine that there might be underlying disease subtypes, and each of these subtypes could have different sets of variables that contribute to that phenotypic outcome. However, when we go to conduct a study, we don't know these subgroups ahead of time unless we can estimate or infer them based on different phenotypic traits observed within these different groups. In other words, maybe the disease is severer in this blue group than it is in the yellow. But this isn't necessarily always the case. So now we're left with a problem of having grouped a bunch of individuals together, not knowing that there are different models that would have best underlied these different subgroups. And this can confound a lot of machine learners that are trying to create a single, holistic model to capture that disease association. The typical approach to tackling heterogeneity is through some form of dataset stratification. In other words, trying to break down our dataset ahead of time to try and pre-capture these heterogeneous subgroups and then conduct modeling within each subgroup. We can do this with something called covariate stratification, where we pick a covariate that we suspect might better separate out our different etiological subgroups. So, as a rough example, imagine we want to split our samples up by sex, and then search for a best model in each. For example, this was done in autism, where a higher prevalence of autism in males than females was observed. However, just separating individuals by sex was certainly not sufficient to detect the underlying complexity of this disease. Another strategy involves cluster stratification. Here we cluster all instances in our dataset and try to pick some homogeneous clusters, perhaps based on genetic homogeneity. Then within these chosen clusters, again, we search for a best model of disease. However, both of these strategies are based on potentially arbitrary assumptions or cutoffs. And while you can get lucky with these approaches, they are by no means a solution to the heterogeneity problem. Heterogeneity is a particularly important problem in precision medicine. For example, when we have some patient group, we want to be able to best determine who will benefit from certain drugs or who will be most likely to have side effects from a given drug. Understanding the underlying heterogeneity of a disease could be the answer to better targeting treatments, preventative medicine, and improving overall patient outcomes. Armed with some of the whys, let's dive into learning classifier systems themselves. Learning classifier systems, or LCSs, were developed primarily for modeling, sequential decision-making, classification, and prediction in complex adaptive systems. They use if-then rules to link independent variable states to some dependent variable states. In other words, if we have these three features with specific values, then we predict some specific class or outcome. As a rule-based machine learning approach, learning classifier systems are largely very interpretable systems. The models that you get from them are a set of if-then rules that can look something like this. If SNP A has value 0 and body mass index is less than 20, then we predict healthy. If SNP X is 1, then we predict case, and so on and so forth. However, unlike expert systems, we're not pre-programming rules, but discovering them through an evolutionary process by learning on training instances. The open-endedness of evolutionary algorithms helps them to be able to discover complex associations that other algorithms might struggle with. As the name implies, learning classifier systems are primarily focused on classification tasks. However, variations have also been adapted for regression. The hallmark to learning classifier systems is that they attempt to capture piecewise learning, or breaking down a complex problem space into smaller pieces. It turns out this is ideal for directly modeling heterogeneous associations like we were just talking about. At the end of the day, LCSs take a different modeling perspective than most machine learning algorithms. And like the no free lunch theorem says, while they won't always be the best algorithm to solve a problem, I would argue that they are a valuable part of any machine learning toolkit. At their essence, learning classifier systems kind of challenge the paradigm of machine learning modeling. Most methods, you have a data set, and you train a single model that covers the problem space. Now, any data point given to that model will use the whole model and all the features specified in it to make a prediction for that data point. On the other hand, rule-based machine learning methods create a model where individual rules cover different parts of the problem space, and those individual rules are only activated when an instance comes along that falls within a specific part of that problem space. So importantly, in LCS, a single rule is not a model. It's the set of rules together that capture and cover the problem space to make predictions. To elaborate on this idea of piecewise learning, we can conceptually think about this using a couple examples of function approximation. Here, the modeling task is to approximate some mathematical function using rules. So if this blue line is our original 2D function, then we might evolve a set of rules that capture linearly little pieces of this overall function. While this might seem inefficient and trivial in this example problem, it's used to illustrate how this piecewise learning might be much more useful in very complex underlying problem space. So here we have a bunch of rules in a visualization that are attempting to capture this 3D mathematical function. Again, we're not trying to train and determine a model that perfectly captures this whole space on its own, but rather a set of individual rules that each capture portions of the model covering the overall problem space. Let's go back to that example of classification boundaries in our machine learning lecture. Here we have our classification data set with cases and controls forming somewhat of a yin-yang pattern. We'd seen previously how different other machine learners attempted to create boundaries identifying what regions of the problem space were going to be predicted as cases or controls. When it comes to learning classifier systems, individual rules are trained which capture different underlying parts of the problem space. And at the end of training, we've formed a more accurate model using a piecewise learning approach. If your intuition leads you to worry that this kind of approach can easily lead to overfitting, as we'll see a little bit later, learning classifier systems also have some really awesome generalization mechanisms that help to avoid overfitting. However, like any machine learner, it is also susceptible to some degree of overfitting. Specific learning classifier system algorithms can be categorized by the type of learning as well as the nature of the endpoints they're trying to predict. Here we're going to focus mostly on supervised learning versions, which can be applied to problems like classification and data mining, or function approximation problems and regression. However, originally, learning classifier systems were developed for reinforcement learning problems and sequential decision-making problems. Here the goal is to find an optimal behavioral policy represented by a compact set of rules. It's also useful to know that there are two major families of learning classifier systems, Michigan style and Pittsburgh style, the names reflecting where these two different styles were born in the literature. In Michigan style learning classifier systems, the entire population of rules, all of this, is the solution. These algorithms learn iteratively, one data point from the dataset at a time, which is pretty unique in contrast to most machine learners, and the genetic algorithm that underlies the discovery mechanism in an LCS operates at the level of individual rules. So in other words, individual rules are mated with one another. When it comes to Pittsburgh-style learning classifier systems, these actually take on a form more similar to a traditional machine learning approach. Here, every rule set, indicated by these set of rules concatenated together, can be a solution. So in other words, after running a Pittsburgh-style system, just one of these smaller rule sets is picked as the final solution, and not all of these rules altogether. Like most machine learners, this variation learns batch-wise, such that we evaluate a rule set on the entire set of training instances and evaluate the rule set as a whole. Here, the genetic algorithm operates at the level of rule sets, so we'll mate an entire rule set with another rule set. As I'd previously mentioned, most machine learners apply batch learning, where an algorithm trains on the entire training dataset all at once. However, with Michigan-style learning classifier systems, we're conducting incremental learning, where we take one data point from the dataset at a time and train on it, then returning it back to the dataset and taking the next one. Here's a schematic laying out a generic supervised learning classifier system. Over here we have the environment, which in this case might just be a dataset, which we're going to use to train our model. Because this is incremental learning, we take one training instance from the dataset at a time. Here we have our rule population. At this point, we find any rules that match the training instance, and this subset of rules forms the match set. Because this is supervised learning, we can then break up the match set into rules that made a correct or incorrect prediction, forming the correct or incorrect sets. Based on whether a rule was correct or incorrect, we can now update parameters of the rules to reflect whether that rule was found to be more or less useful. Next, we take this correct set and pick parent rules, applying a genetic algorithm in rule discovery. We breed these best rules together and form two new offspring rules. Here we'll use the standard genetic operators of crossover and mutation. These rules are then returned to the population, and the population size is then maintained by some deletion mechanism. Other mechanisms that we'll talk more about later include covering, which is a way to randomly initialize rules, and subsumption, which is an explicit generalization mechanism to keep the algorithm from overfitting as much. This cycle is repeated many times, such that we get an evolving population of rules. At the end of the run, we can then apply some rule compaction algorithm to eliminate any rules that are still young and naive or rules that are clearly bad. This gives us our final rule population that can be used as a model. As I mentioned, learning classifier systems were originally designed for reinforcement learning. These algorithms have very similar sets of components, but they operate just a little bit differently. In particular, because we don't know whether a prediction is correct or not at any given time, instead of forming a correct and incorrect set, after we form a match set, we use a prediction array to try and predict what action we should take next, or in some cases, to pick a random action to explore the search space. This action is sent to the environment, where occasionally we'll get feedback in the form of reward, maybe when we reach the end of a maze, or some other multi-step task is completed and deserving of a reward. Whenever a reward is found, the credit assignment mechanism tries to backpropagate reward to the rules in the population that made that success ultimately possible. Again, this cycle is repeated many, many times, trying to train a set of rules that captures some desired behavior when interacting with an environment. Now to elaborate off of those initial schematics, I'm going to take a more detailed walkthrough of a learning classifier system, here mostly focusing on those designed for supervised learning. So again, we have this schematic of a learning classifier system designed for supervised learning. As mentioned, we start with our data set that would be considered to be our environment, and notably, like an intelligent agent, an LCS can have detectors and effectors to interact with the environment if this were a reinforcement learning problem. Unlike most evolutionary algorithms, a learning classifier system's population typically starts off empty. The rule population itself is a finite set of rules, which we call set P, which collectively explores the search space. Every valid rule can be thought of as part of a candidate solution. The space of all candidate solutions is termed the search space, and the size of the search space is determined both by the encoding of LCS rules and the target problem itself. The maximum population size is one of the most critical run parameters of an LCS algorithm. This is usually specified by the user and often will range anywhere from 200 to 20,000 rules. But successfully setting this parameter depends on the dataset dimensions and the complexity of the problem. If the population is too small, the solution may never be found. And if it's too large, the runtime or memory limits of the algorithm could be too extreme. Let's take a closer look at the rules of an LCS or the classifiers in an LCS themselves. In thinking of a rule, let's use this analogy. A rule is a termite in a mound. And such, a rule is not its own viable solution. Only in collaboration with other rules is the solution space covered. The population is basically a container for rules. The term classifier basically describes a rule with some condition and action combined with some rule parameters, such as the fitness or accuracy of the rule. These parameters are updated every learning iteration for any rules that have been relevant to that cycle or that have ended up in the match set that cycle. To better understand how rules capture patterns in the data, let's look at a specific example where we have two SNPs, two single nucleotide polymorphisms, with genotypes encoded as 0, 1, or 2 for each, and each genotype combination has its own penetrance value indicated with a probability, where a probability of 1 means that that genotype combination always results in disease, and a probability of 0 would indicate that that genotype combination never results in disease. So let's say this is a real-world association where having genotype 2 for SNP 3 and having genotype 0 for SNP 4 results in a high probability of disease, 90% here. This genetic combination would basically infer a high-risk genotype combination that we'd want to discover. In a real-world training instance that contains this information, we might have a set of SNPs with SNPs 3 and 2 indicating that particular genotypic combination. And indeed, this individual does have a status of sick, where we use the encoding 1 rather than the encoding 0. If the learning classifier system does its job, you'll end up seeing a rule that looks like this. Learning classifier system rules traditionally use hashtags to indicate wildcards. This allows a rule to generalize over different features in the problem space. So basically, this rule says if SNP 3 has a value of 2 and SNP 4 has a value of 0, then we predict that this individual is sick. This rule will match any instance where SNP 3 has a value of 2 and SNP 4 has a value of 4. It won't care what the other feature values are. Learning classifier systems actually have many different rule representations possible, but the most traditional is this ternary representation. Again, hashtags are used to denote wildcards. In ternary encoding, we can only insert the characters 1, 0, or hashtag. The assumption here is that any real-world problem values have been converted to binary. However, there are many other encodings. For example, a simple quaternary encoding could be applied to SNP data, where rules can have a value of hashtag 0, 1, or 2 in any of these positions. There are also encodings for rules that allow for real-valued numbers, and other more sophisticated encodings that are more computationally efficient. Most of my own learning classifier system implementations use something called a mixed discrete continuous ALKR representation. It sounds complicated, but it's actually very straightforward. This kind of representation allows us to apply these methods to larger scale datasets as they're more computationally efficient. Also, they allow for datasets with mixed data types, including variables that are discrete, such as binary, integers, or even strings, or continuous or real valued numbers. So basically, the way this works is that a rule is represented using an attribute reference. This is basically an index to the position of the feature in the dataset. And for each of these, a corresponding rule condition. What is the value of that feature at that index? So in other words, this rule says that feature 5 can have a value between 0.1 and 0.5 to match. Feature 7 has to have a value of 1. Feature 34 has to have a value of 2. Feature 35 has to have a value between this range. Feature 49 has to have the value text being high. And feature 71 has to have a value of 0. If all of these are true, then this rule would match, and the rule would make the prediction of 1, in this case being sick. Here we can see a ternary rule representation translated into this mixed representation, where we have features in positions 3 and 4 having values 2 and 0. Going back to our growing schematic of an LCS algorithm, at this point we've grabbed a data point and passed it to our empty population. Each learning cycle all of the learning and discovery that's going to take place is going to be focused on this particular training instance. So as you might expect, these systems are designed to run for many, many training iterations. Once the training instance is passed along, we attempt to match that training instance to different rules in our population, and this will form a match set. Let's take a look at matching itself. Let's say that this is an example of an instance from our data set. And let's say that this represents a rule in our population. In this case, these rules would match because each value specified in the rule is equivalent to the value found in the training instance. Here's another example where our rule matches our training instance. And here's an example where our rule does not match our training instance. Specifically, we have one specified value here that is not the same as the training instance value at that same position. And down here, we have yet another example of a rule that matches the current training instance. Notably, if a rule existed with all hashtags, it would match any training instance. But at the same time, such a rule would be useless. Here's a table that outlines how matching would occur using different kinds of rule representations, including ternary, integer, continuous valued using real upper and lower bounds, and continuous valued using center spread rules. Feel free to examine this table if you want to learn more of these subtleties. Okay, so at this point, we've passed a training instance along and tried to form a match set. But if we're starting with an empty population, we're ultimately going to find an empty match set. So what do we do in this situation? Well, at this point, the covering mechanism kicks in. This is one of the two ways that rules are discovered or introduced into the rule population. Usually, covering is most important for just initializing our rule population, and it doesn't do too much typically once the algorithm has started running after a while. Covering initializes a rule by generalizing the current training instance in a random way. So let's say that this is our current training instance, and we want to generate a new random rule. We'll randomly select positions in this instance and add hashtags or wildcards to generate a new rule. When we're doing supervised learning, we make sure that the class matches the class of the training instance. So basically, we're speculating that this rule might be useful in predicting this training instance. Of course, we don't know this yet, but over the course of many learning iterations, we expect the learning classifier system to figure this out. Notably, covering will only add rules to the population that match at least one data instance in the dataset. This avoids the problem of searching irrelevant parts of the search space. To understand why this is so important, imagine if we randomly generated rules at the start of a run. We could easily accidentally generate some rules that would never match anything in our data set and thus are totally useless to us. Now let's say that covering created an initial rule, which then matched. So now we have at least one rule in our match set. Now we can apply the prediction array if we'd like. If we're doing supervised learning, the prediction array plays no real part in the training or learning process. It's only useful in making novel predictions on unseen data or evaluating predictive performance on the training data during the course of training. So basically, the prediction array is used to try and make predictions using the current rules in the match set. However, if this was reinforcement learning, as I mentioned earlier, this prediction array is really an important part of the learning process in that it decides how to exploit the information we've learned so far, or it decides to explore and choose a random action to see if that might be good in the given situation. As I've implied, when we form a match set, you can have rules that advocate different classes in that match set. And ultimately, we'll want to predict a class using this machine learner. Here's the part of the schematic for supervised learning, where we have the prediction array coming off the match set. And down here in reinforcement learning, the prediction array is a necessary step to select an action to apply to the environment. The prediction array could be set up to work deterministically, where we just pick the classifier with the best fitness in the match set, or most commonly, they're applied probabilistically, where the class with the best average fitness across rules in the match set determine the best class that's going to be chosen. Okay, so back to our schematic. After we formed our match set, given that we're doing supervised learning, we're now going to form our correct and incorrect sets. Any rule in our match set that asserts the correct current class of the current training instance forms the correct set, and those that don't form the incorrect set. Let's look at a quick example of matching and forming the correct set. Here we have our data instance and some rules that might exist in our population. We're going to take the first rule and compare it to see if it matches. In this case, it doesn't, so we throw it out. Then we'll look at our next rule, and we see in this case it does match. Then we look at our third rule, and again we see this matches as well. These rules form the match set. Next, we're going to try and form the correct set. And we're going to form the incorrect set. The correct set includes the rule that has the same outcome value as the training instance, and the incorrect set includes any matching rule that doesn't have the correct outcome. To start to see how this works at a broader scale, imagine we have this entire set of rules in our population. A training instance comes along, and using the analogy of the brain, we could say that just the neurons in the brain that are responsible for controlling a specific task are lit up and activated to help in the decision-making process, rather than the entire brain at once. So here, all rules that match are lit up, and then we form a correct set based on all matching rules that also assert the correct prediction. All right, back to our schematic. The next step, number 7, is updating the rule parameters. A number of rule parameters are stored for every rule in a learning classifier system, and there are different parameters depending on the type of learning classifier system you're using. In supervised learning classifier systems, there are notably fewer run parameters than in their reinforcement learning cousins. This update of the rule parameters happens after the formation of the match set and either the correct set or action set if we're doing reinforcement learning. Typically, we're focusing on updating the rule parameters of any rule that has ended up in the match set this iteration. In updating parameters, we can think of this simply as rules in the correct set getting a boost in accuracy, and rules in the match set that didn't make it into the correct set get a decrease in accuracy. The experience of any rule in the population is tracked as the number of training iterations where it ends up in a match set. The accuracy of a given rule is basically the number of correct classifications that rule has made divided by its experience. So notably, the accuracy of a rule is a different thing than the accuracy of a whole model. As an example, imagine that a rule only ever matches one instance in the training data, and when it matches, it makes the correct prediction. That rule could have an accuracy of 1, but it's only relevant to one data point in the entire data set. Obviously, the point of generating rules in a learning classifier system is to come up with accurate rules that also cover as many instances in the data set as possible. This pushes them to generalize rather than overfit the problem space. The fitness, which is used to drive the evolutionary mechanisms in an LCS, is computed as a simple function of accuracy, usually accuracy to the power of some constant. This constant is used to better separate out classifiers with similar accuracy values. Basically, you can think of this constant as the amount of pressure we want to place on the LCS to yield rules that are 100% accurate. In noisy problem domains like we find in medicine, we expect a lot of noise in our dataset, and thus we don't want to overemphasize the accuracy of our individual rules. This will just lead to overfitting in problem domains where we already expect noise. The next stage in the cycle is subsumption, which is the generalization mechanism I mentioned earlier. Notably, learning classifier systems have both an explicit and implicit generalization pressure. Subsumption represents the explicit pressure, and the implicit pressure comes from how rules are potentially selected as parents by the evolutionary algorithm. In particular, simpler rules that have more wildcards are ultimately going to end up being in match sets more often because they're easier to match. Because of this, those rules will have a higher reproductive opportunity when parent selection occurs. This is an implicit underlying pressure that encourages rules in the learning classifier system to be as simple as possible. Now let's take a quick moment to explain this subsumption mechanism. Imagine we have these three rules, A, B, and C, that look as such. I've represented these rules in this little Venn diagram, illustrating what part of the problem space each rule covers. Notably, rule A is more general. In other words, it only specifies two features, while rules B and C specify 3 or 4. Notice that rule A completely encapsulates rules B and C. We can see this because the variables specified in A also exist in B and in C, but B adds one other specified feature, and C specifies 2 other features. In this example, A is a possible subsumer of both B and C, but B is not a possible subsumer of C, because not all features in B are also specified in C. The way subsumption works is that if we have a more general rule, like rule A, and it's just as accurate as more specific rules, let's say B or C, then rule A will basically eat that subsumable rule, where A will become stronger and B and C will disappear from the population. This explicit generalization pressure, again, helps to promote generality in the rule population. The next step of the cycle is application of a genetic algorithm for rule discovery. In a learning classifier system, the genetic algorithm works a little bit differently than a standalone genetic algorithm that we've discussed earlier in a previous lecture. Here, generally, two parents are picked from a pool of potential candidates. different learning classifier systems might use different potential parent selection pools. For example, some LCSs use a panmictic pool, where parents are selected from the entire population. In other examples, they're selected from just the matched set, and in most modern supervised learning LCSs, they're selected from the correct set. The selection strategy that's applied can either be deterministic, in other words, we can pick the rules with the best fitness from that selection pool. We could choose parents randomly, which is rarely used because it's not terribly advantageous and kind of against the purpose of an evolutionary approach. Or it can be probabilistic, which is the most widely used approach. This tends to pick the higher fit parents, but also allows for some randomness and stochasticity to help avoid local optima. The most common approaches for probabilistic selection include roulette wheel selection and tournament selection. In tournament selection, let's say we have this population of rules represented by these rows. If we want to select parents from this population, we'll first randomly pick a tournament group, grabbing some predetermined number of rules from the population. Then we pick the highest fit rule found in this random selection to be the parent. Since we need two parents for the mating, we complete this tournament selection twice and grab two different parents. When it comes to roulette wheel selection, we look at the fitness of each rule, and that fitness becomes a proportion on a roulette wheel, indicating the probability that that individual will be selected as a parent. Once we create the wheel, we conduct spins, where each spin will select a single parent. The last component of this cycle is deletion. If we didn't have deletion, the rule population would grow without bound, and would be a waste of memory, and of course computational runtime. Most commonly, a panmictic deletion is used. In other words, we select individuals for deletion from the population as a whole. The probability of being deleted is usually a function of rule fitness, as well as possibly rule age, the average size of the correct sets that that rule belongs to, and the numerosity of the rule, where the numerosity of a rule is another rule parameter that captures how many virtual copies of that rule are stored in a population at once. We do this because we don't want redundant rules cluttering up the population, so we always check if a rule already exists in the population once we discover it, either with covering or the GA. After this cycle has been run some number of times, we get an output population that we could then apply immediately as a prediction model. However, typically we apply rule compaction at this point, because when you stop learning classifier learning at any given time, there's always going to be some rules that have been added recently that haven't gotten a chance to see much or really any of the training data, and thus are not reliable. So it's usually good to filter these out, or to try and compact the rule population down to just those most necessary rules. This can help improve our ability to interpret the set of rules, since instead of maybe thousands or hundreds, we could have a much smaller number to consider. If you're interested in learning more about learning classifier systems, I've created this YouTube video available at this link. As you can see, it's an animated video that gives about a 12-minute introduction to learning classifier systems. If anything confused you in this section of the lecture, this is a great first place to start to better understand the basics of a learning classifier system. If you're inspired and really want to learn more about these algorithms, I co-authored an introductory textbook on the topic of learning classifier systems with my colleague Will Brown at the University of Wellington, New Zealand, published in 2017. You can search for this book and find it on Amazon. So now that you've got an in-depth look at a basic learning classifier system, let's quickly review some of their advantages. First, they're adaptive machine learners. They can actually adapt their model to a changing environment. Because these models are developed piecewise, we can introduce new training information downstream and just adapt the model from where we left off. These methods are also model-free, and they make limited assumptions about the patterns in the dataset. This allows them to find complex relationships, including epistatic and heterogeneous associations. It also makes no assumptions about the number of predictive versus non-predictive attributes in the data, so like many other machine learners, they can also conduct internal feature selection during the training process. Further, you can think of learning classifier systems sort of as their own ensemble learner. So in essence, you're not trying to train a single cohesive model to make predictions, but you're trying to find a set of rules that collaboratively vote on making predictions. This tends to make them more reliable. Also, because these methods use evolutionary algorithms, they have a stochastic component to their learning. This kind of non-deterministic learning is advantageous in large-scale or high-complexity problems where deterministic learning methods are typically intractable. Learning classifiers are also implicitly multi-objective, in that rules tend to evolve towards a state of accuracy as well as generality and simplicity, thanks to the explicit and implicit generalization pressures we mentioned earlier. Further, in contrast to many machine learning algorithms, LCSs tend to be very interpretable. Of course, depending on the rule representation, rules can be pretty human readable, coming in the form of simple if-then statements. The main struggle in interpreting LCS models is to determine which rules to focus on the most, or how to interpret rules as an entire population at once. Our own research group has spent a lot of time developing nice visualization strategies to extract global patterns from the rule population, not only to identify important features, but to characterize underlying patterns of association, including epistasis and genetic heterogeneity. In terms of disadvantages, learning classifier systems are still widely unknown. Even though I've been in this field for over a decade, most people, even those that practice machine learning, have never heard of this family of algorithms. Also, previously, there was relatively limited software accessibility in order to be able to run one of these systems easily. However, our group has created a number of implementations and made them available as scikit-learn packages. So this is changing. Further, even though generally I would call these systems interpretable, there are still challenges in rule population interpretation. And like any machine learner, learning classifier systems suffer from overfitting, despite the explicit and implicit generalization pressures I mentioned. Further, due to the complexity and stochasticity of these methods, there's relatively little theoretical work or convergence proofs regarding these methodologies. And there are often a number of run parameters to consider or optimize. Here's the schematic for our own learning classifier system called Extracts that was designed to be applied to biomedical data mining problems. I won't get into detail, but the main features of this approach include the ability to incorporate expert knowledge to better guide the evolutionary search, rule compaction strategies that are better suited to dealing with the noisy problem space of biomedical problems, and the incorporation of attribute tracking, a mechanism we developed that allows us to reverse engineer heterogeneous subgroups in the dataset over the course of LCS training. Here we take a slightly closer look at attribute tracking. Basically, this is a form of long-term memory akin to how ants leave pheromone paths behind in ant colony optimization. However, instead here, during the course of learning, whenever a correct set is formed, we look at what features have been specified in correct rules for a given training instance in the dataset. For those features, we take the accuracy of the rule and add it as an increasing sum that represents the pheromone left behind by, let's say, a virtual ant. Effectively, what this does is store over time what features were most important for making accurate predictions about individual instances in the dataset. Here we can see a visualization of these attribute tracking scores where we have features as rows and training instances as columns. In this example, we've modeled two heterogeneous subgroups in the dataset, one that involve features X2 and X3, and another that involves X0 and X1. This pattern was noisily simulated, and we can see that attribute tracking really nicely identifies these two heterogeneous subgroups underlying the dataset. So now instead of trying to identify subgroups ahead of time before machine learning and applying modeling subsequently based on our best guess, here we're attempting to identify etiological subgroups driven by predictive features after the fact of machine learning training. We can then interrogate these identified subgroups later to see if there are differences in other phenotypic outcomes, disease severity, or to create this homogeneous data set for further statistical or machine learning analysis. In a previous study of bladder cancer, we identified two heterogeneous subgroups distinguished by having been a heavy smoker versus having a specific genotype combination of having two DNA repair SNPs as an example of phenocopy. After identifying these subgroups, we identified a clinically meaningful difference in survivorship between these two identified groups. So in summary, today I've provided an introduction to rule-based machine learning, talking first about association rule mining, then about artificial immune systems, and finally learning classifier systems. Here's today's quote. You have to learn the rule of the game, and then you have to play better than anyone else. Just a reminder that your final project presentations will be coming up soon, as well as your final project reports. Please check the syllabus for details. As always, thank you for your attention. I hope you enjoyed this class, and I hope to hear from you in the future. Thanks again.